Here follows an extract from my book Artful Designs, available from Amazon. Chapter 5, Part 2. Beth and Drew were about their usual weekday routine, which invariably involved numerous shared tea breaks. They'd established a pattern during their early years together, based around the vending machine at Art College, which soon extended to tea and cake eaten around their respective timetables, and also, if they'd admit it, during a few scheduled lectures that they'd forgotten to attend. Life carried on now, in much the same way, after a couple of chaotic decades and three children later. During the week, Drew worked in his studio when not at the Whitworth. His work varied from the various commissions to convert architectural schematics into artists' impressions of the finished building, complete with potted plants and imaginary landscapes, through to corporate boardroom artwork. Beth pottered about the house attending to the domestic fear, marked theory exam papers and taught piano most evenings. All of this could be interrupted at any moment by either of their boys who chose to come home uninvited, or more often by their daughter Emma and their granddaughter Primrose. In such cases, Drew would exchange his watercolours, oils and drawing board for pencil crayons and the kitchen table with Primrose, who at 6 years old demanded such attention and innumerable colours. Even without these pleasant unscheduled interruptions, their routine was regularly interspersed with tea breaks, which were signalled at will by the ring of a service bell. Beth had launched the institution when the children were small, and she grew tired of yelling over the house that dinner was ready. As the children's understanding matured, the system of ringing became more sophisticated. The first ring meant that the dinner was almost ready. The second ring meant that dinner was served. If there was a third ring, it was more urgent and frantic, meaning that dinner was now going cold and you'd have to hurry before your meal was in the dustbin. Nobody ever dared push for a fourth ring. That same old bell served a similar purpose still. The only real change was that it was now rung less repeatedly and with less violent tones. It also now reported that the kettle had boiled and the tea was brewed. Not surprisingly, since the robbery at the gallery, Beth and Drew had found it difficult to focus on their usual duties, and the bell had been working overtime as they talked over recent events and the implications for themselves and those they knew. Beth was in the process of repeating the ritual yet again when her brother strode into the kitchen and greeted her with his usual bear hug. Any physical similarities which they had once shared when they were young were now forgotten. Beth was much daintier than her twin brother. Benedict was heavy-set, with big bones and solid proportions, at a towering 6'2" tall. Beth's hair was pale brown, whereas Benedict's was dark brown, almost black, albeit now peppered with a distinguished grey. Beth had hazel-coloured eyes, but Benedict's were a deep brown, which could have seemed sorrowful, were it not for the crow's feet at the edge of his eyes, which belied an inclination to laugh. They had, however, retained a sensitivity to each other's mood, and their thinking invariably followed similar lines. They also shared in continuing a family heritage for logical reasoning and problem-solving. Joint research had revealed that their maternal grandmother had been involved in the code deciphering team at Bletchley Park, and her personal speciality of decloaking misdemeanour was also a trait that her grandchildren continued to credit. Benji, I'm so pleased to see you. It's so awful and we just can't concentrate on anything properly. We simply can't think of anything other than the robbery. Drew will be through any second. I've rung the bell for tea. Then you can tell us all about it, said Beth. As predicted, Drew had quickly responded to the summons of the bell and they gathered around the kitchen table. What's the state of play, Benji? Asked Drew. Is it certain that Finn is the culprit? Nothing is certain at all just now. Don't you worry, though, we'll get to the bottom of this. And I do quite literally mean we, said Benedict. In response to their inquiring glances, he explained. Thanks to a shortfall in manpower, I'm on secondment to the Met's Antiques and Arts Squad. I can also commandeer our dear friend Maddox from your own humble constabulary. We are back in business. Oh, that's brilliant. I felt so helpless not being able to do anything. But if we can help you in any way, you know we will, said Beth. That's exactly what I was banking on you saying. I'm afraid that Drew will have to come under the microscope just like everybody else. But as soon as that's cleared up, we can crack on unshackled, said Benedict. Oh, don't mind me, said Drew. You can get the interrogation lights out and turn them on to full beam as far as I'm concerned. It's young Scott that I'm worried about. I'm not concerned about his actual innocence. That's a given as far as I'm concerned. But proving it won't be so easy. Proving guilt where it's appropriate won't be easy either. And I don't want the lad to have a cloud of doubt hanging over him just because we can't point the finger at the real villain. Something like that could totally ruin his chances, no matter how much we say he's innocent until proven otherwise. The bad news is that, according to the experts, the clear-up rate for crime in the art world is less than good, but I won't sit back and accept that. I'm hoping that we can do better. Between us, we'll have all angles covered. I've got the official clout, and you've got inside knowledge, said Benedict. Do you think it was Finn who broke in and stole the constable? Asked Beth. We're presuming so for now, and it's highly likely to be the case. Even so, we can't ignore other possibilities. We can't know for sure until he's found and brought in for questioning. The one quick glimpse, which is only for a fraction of a second before the system shuts down, shows a figure of Finn's height and stature. But his head is covered by a hoodie and his face is concealed behind a mask of sorts, probably a stereotypical balaclava. It's most probably him, but we can't be totally certain yet. In my experience, there never is a mysterious Mr. X. It's usually the prime suspect and it's usually somebody that you know. I do agree with Scott that it just doesn't make sense for Finn to move into high art crime. His main idea would be to make life difficult for Scott, which doesn't suggest stealing one particular piece of art, said Drew. We don't know that the piece was particularly chosen or if it was just chance that dictated what was taken. We can't know that until we speak to Finn. He's gone to ground for the time being, which does bolster the theory that he's our man. He'll have to surface sooner or later, then we'll have him. What's going on at the gallery, Drew? Said Benedict. I'm not there every day, but I gather that Theo has told everyone to stay away for a few days. The forensic team are just finishing up and the builders get back to work tomorrow, but he's told everybody to take the rest of the week off, saying he'll call us if he needs anything. Theo reckons that we all need just to calm down for a bit and let the dust settle, said Drew. Very sound advice. Do you think so? I think it's a ruse because Theo is in a huge temper and can't stand the thought of seeing Scott there. He can't tell Scott to stay away and let us carry on as normal, so this is the next best thing, said Drew. Well, if it's his own feathers that need to settle, that advice is still good. After that, he'll have to get over it and let us do our job. Life has to carry on and he must abide by the law too. He's first on my list for tomorrow. I'll have a quiet word with him to remind him of the fact, said Benedict. Beth glanced at the clock and mentioned that she needed to prepare for her evening's pupils. You will keep us informed, won't you? I understand the whole confidentiality thing, but we'll help as much as we can. I'm counting on it, Beth. Meanwhile, I'm going to head on over to Mossleigh Station to see if I can purloin Maddox. I wonder if he fancies himself as an art sleuth, said Benedict. I know that he fancies himself as your sidekick. If you don't rescue him, all he has to look forward to is policing Mossleigh Village Flower Festival and our annual croquet competition, said Beth. Poor lad. If I'd have known that, I'd have gone there first to give him a ray of hope. I'll march over to his rescue this very moment, said Benedict. For the full book of Artful Designs, available in paperback or as an e-book, follow the link in the cards in the description box or find details on my website at sharonbill.com. Thanks for listening.